on TW.
See ya.
Take it easy. But take it.
What's next?
Now we can start strut. One thing you gotta learn, kid. You gotta look and act like other people.
Hell, when I first got to France and read the critiques of René, Godard, Truffaut, Romain, I didn't know who the hell they were talking about, no. But that's the way film should be. An artist should not moralize. A person who has the audacity to make a film in the first place shouldn't ever consciously put his own neuroses on screen.
Well, most of your heroes are pretty neurotic.
My heroes are no more neurotic than the audience. Unless you can feel that a hero is just as fucked up as you are and that you would make the same mistakes that he would make, you can have no satisfaction when he does commit an heroic act. Because then you can say, hell, I could have done that too. And that's the obligation of the filmmaker, of the theater worker, to give a heightened sense of experience to the people who pay to come to see his work.
From 1947 to 1962, Nicholas Ray directed some of the most richly personal work in American cinema. Yet in 1971, when he accepted a teaching post at Harper College in Binghamton, New York, he had not completed a film in nearly a decade. At Binghamton, Ray trained his students to be a working production unit, teaching them filmmaking by shooting a feature film as a collaborative creative effort under his supervision.
Grow, not grow, the word didn't go, but become us.
You just described it.
All right.
Places, please. Yeah. Places.
Go.
Scene, one age, take one.
Action.
Born in 1911, Nicholas Ray left his hometown of La Crosse, Wisconsin at 16 to study under Frank Lloyd Wright. After a brief university career, Ray emigrated to New York City at the height of the Depression. There he became involved in the lively experimental theater of the 30s, working as an actor with such politically progressive groups as the Workers' Theater and the Federal Theater Project, which included the Living Newspaper. It was there that Ray learned the improvisational methods that he would employ in Hollywood and would still be using with his students in Binghamton more than 30 years later.
It began on East 12th Street, not a few blocks from here. Led to my association with Kazan and Houseman, from whom I learned more than any other two people in the world. I worked in a workers' theater. We graduated to Broadway. And somehow or other, one day, Kazan said, come on, you've been spending enough time in radio, theater, television. I'm going out to Hollywood to make my first film. Come on along and help me. Houseman, same thing. I suppose I've collaborated with Houseman on more things than anybody else I've ever worked with.
Nick had come to New York during the depths of the Depression, when life was very strange, so rather desperate, and at the same time extremely hopeful, and there was almost no limit to the dreams one could have, because everything was so terrible that everything was dreams. Nick was himself a very vulnerable, very sensitive, almost too sensitive person in some ways, in some ways very aggressive and assertive, in other ways extremely reticent and shy. And that combination is very good for a director with actors. Particularly, his real talent lay in what he could do with very young and tender and sensitive and insecure people, like Kathy O'Donnell, Farley Granger.
Do you do them, Marion?
That's my business. I have a $30 wedding which gives a complete recording of the ceremony on records. I have a $20 wedding...
Will you just marry us?
That'll be $20. Tilly, Herman?
Who are they?
My sister and her husband. Witnesses.
We have to have them?
Oh, yeah. First, you gotta sign your names. Over here. If you'll, just sign the register. Now, rent your ring for a dollar, or sell you one for five.
I'll buy one.
This one will do it. By virtue of the power vested in me, I hereby perform this wedding ceremony. Do you, Catherine, take this man, Arthur, as your lawful wedded husband, to love, honor, and cherish henceforth?
I do.
Do you, Arthur, take this woman, Catherine, as your lawful wedded wife, to love, honor, and cherish henceforth?
I do.
Well, put the ring on her finger. Now, by virtue of the power vested in me, I now pronounce you husband and wife. Tip him each a dollar.
wish all the health, happiness, and wealth in the world.
Herman, you got a cold.
I'm sorry, I have.
That'll be $20 plus $5 for the ring. You don't think much of my way of marrying people, do you?
I sure don't.
Well, me neither. But I'm giving folks what they want. It's my way of thinking folks ought to have what they want. As long as they can pay for it.
Nick has always made, almost all his best pictures, actually, have been about people whom society was oppressing and society was crushing and who were almost doomed to be defeated by society. Well, Nick himself is not altogether outside that category.
In 1962, having become one of the highest paid American directors, Nicholas Ray dropped out of the film industry, plagued by personal problems and discouraged by the compromises of commercial movie making. For Ray, the 60s were a long, murky period, marred by a stream of unrealized projects and by failing health. In 1969, he returned to the United States after a 10-year absence to make a film about the Chicago conspiracy trial.
What was it that captured your attention at the conspiracy trial?
Well, it was the greatest circus of bigotry I had ever heard, directed against young people who were now the 32 and 33-year-old equivalents of James Dean, who wrote pamphlets that were of such sophomoric and collegiate humor, like the stuff you write before homecoming games, which were taken seriously by the court. So one day Lee Weiner came to me and asked if I were a friend of Groucho Marx's, and I said, yes. He said, do you suppose we could get Groucho as an expert witness for us? And so we'll try. And he says, somebody has to explain our sense of humor. And he's the only man in the United States that we know of who can explain our sense of humor. And to see Dave Dellinger, the oldest of the group, and a Quaker pacifist, be the only one to put his body in front of Bobby Seale to protect him from the blows of the police. So many things. I'll make it someday. After we finish this one, maybe. And the next one. Hey, you bums, look at them. Hey, look at that bunch of... Look at those magnificent bastards in there. Hey, get a shot of those cats in there.
Well... Huh? I was talking to Howard Hughes.
Oh, get in the window, you schmuck. Hey, you're get in the window. Yeah.
Francois Boucher with you. And he says you're a bastard.
I see you got your pancake on over there.
He says you're a bastard.
Nick came and virtually changed the whole cinema department, the whole idea of filmmaking. And I think he has a huge amount of insight into everybody he's known for a while. He employs those insights for characters in a film, even. He's a con artist, and he knows how to manipulate people, if that's an acceptable word, but that's part of the talent of a director. He's always wanted to be cherished by young people, and he scorns his own generation, which has rejected him, apparently. And he just likes working with young people. As far as his role in the film, which is a essential part of the whole film, he's, as a character, I guess he's something like the parole officer in Rebel, always caring for young people, and he's been like a father to us and a counselor and a teacher at the same time.
Ray's unconventional teaching methods demanded intensive involvement from his students, leading them to adopt a communal living arrangement that brought down continual harassment from conservative university authorities. Eventually, the group was forced to move to a farm just outside of town. Gradually, under Ray's direction, teacher and students alike attempted to develop an original approach to filmmaking that would express in a new way the process of self-discovery that has always been one of Nick Ray's central themes.
Look, I like this quality on here better than I like the corrected one.
Which one is that?
The overexposed one.
Why do you like that one better?
Because I like it better. This is dull. This is one of the many aesthetic arguments. Character in the world. Look at this.
I know which shot it is. I know which shot it is.
So this is dull as hell, you know?
How did Bogart take to playing the part of the writer in A Lonely Place, which is rather a departure for him?
Well, I had taken the gun away from his hand for the first time in Knock on Any Door. And the second time, he was ready for it, a little bit more ready for it. And he obviously loved it. It's one of his favorite films. But it was a very personal story. A very personal story. The last part of it, I had written with Andrew Zolt, and Zolt had headed east. In the meantime, I had separated from my wife, Gloria Graham, who was playing opposite Bogie. And if I had let the producer, Bobby Lord, or Bogie know that, you know, they would have gone crazy, or Harry Cohn would have gone crazy. And so I said, well, look, I'm having trouble with the third act. Make an apartment for me out of a couple dressing rooms, because I don't want to drive to Malibu every night. And I want to get down and get on stage and work at night, which I did. And Gloria behaved beautifully. Nobody knew that we were separated. And I just couldn't believe the ending that Bundy and I had written. I shot it because it was my obligation to do it. Then I kicked everybody off stage except Bogart, Art Smith, and Gloria. And we improvised the ending as it is now. The original ending we had written so that it was all tied up into a very neat package. Frank Lovejoy coming in and arresting him as he was writing the last lines, having killed Gloria. And I thought, what shit? I can't do it. I just can't do it. Romances don't have to end that way. Marriages don't have to end that way. They don't have to end in violence, for Christ's sake, you know. And let the audience find out and make up its own mind about what's going to happen to Bogie and when he goes outside of the apartment area, which was the first apartment I lived in Hollywood, by the way. This is a very personal film.
Bogart plays a neurotic screenwriter with a violent temper who is unjustly suspected of murder. The police investigation places an intolerable strain on his relationship with Gloria Graham.
He scared me. There.
So are you taking to Las Vegas?
I just started to pack when you came.
I thought you said you were in bed.
No, I know.
Are you packing to go on a honeymoon?
Yes, of course.
Are you packing to run away from me like you ran away from Mr. Baker?
Stop it, Dick. I can't take any more of this.
Hello? Who? Oh, I'll give her the message. You have a cancellation on flight 16 for New York. I'll tell her. cancellation on flight 16 for New York.
I'll stay with you, Dix. I promise I'll stay with you. I love you, Dix. I'll marry you. I'll go away with you. Take me, Dix.
Away from me the first chance you get.
Don't act like this, Dix. I can't live with a maniac.
I'll never let you go.
We see them together and talking right after my rap for the detective.
Working within the studio system, Ray, like other directors, often had to relinquish control of a picture at the vital stage of editing.
We mix the speaker over this. Take is this?
This is like take four or something.
Well, listen to take six.
Six?
If there is one. And also, I want to put back in, because in seeing the assemblage in Boston, it struck me that we have no resolution to this at all, and we must have that jump of listening into Doug's.
Why don't you do the tape over there?
Oh, yes, sure.
How did you approach your cutting in Hollywood?
But I would cut every night after shooting.
As you went?
Right. I'll usually have a rough cut of the film within a week after I finished. But this is different. This is a... This is a method of teaching. That we've come out with a film is, we hope, a very lucky accident.
Now crescendo, right from here.
Before
this part comes in before that.
Now, let's listen to another take if you can.
Okay.
Because I have one which is almost on the nose.
When do you want the crescendo?
Crescendo begins while we're on their backs.
Oh, right, while we're on their backs.
Right there.
Right, so if I cut two bars, I think that'll...
No, the two bars will bring you into the la-la-la-la.
How have you organized your students' work on this production?
Following the rotation system with somebody being on one sequence, somebody else being on another sequence. And finding that a person who may be emotionally involved in one sequence may not be doing as good an editing job as somebody else might do. Take him off, put him onto something else.
Do you find you, can you get a consistent rhythm to the picture with all this?
That's my final job. Everything that goes through here now goes through me. Finally, there can only be the...
Finally, there must be the director.
Whenever you're ready, Luke.
Yeah, okay. 16, ready.
Turn up the lights, please.
When the young French critics first began to develop the auteur theory, the concept of the director as the central creative force in the making of a film was a new one. No other American director attracted more sustained enthusiasm from François Truffaut, Jean-Luc Godard, and their colleagues than Nicolas Ray.
Je crois que ce qui nous avait attiré, c'est qu'il y avait quelque chose d'européen chez cet homme d'Hollywood, en fait. Et qu'est-ce qu'il y avait d'européen? C'était peut-être la fragilité, la vulnérabilité des personnages principaux. Bien qu'il tournait quelquefois avec des vedettes comme John Wayne ou Humphrey Bogart, et ces personnages masculins n'étaient pas macho ou Sterling Hayden, il y avait cette grande sensibilité et... Surtout dans le traitement, je dois dire, des histoires sentimentales, qui donnaient une impression de très grande réalité, à une époque où le cinéma d'Hollywood n'était pas facilement personnel ou autobiographique, on avait toujours l'impression que les histoires d'amour dans les films de Nicolas Ray étaient des histoires vraies.
How many men have you forgotten?
As many women as you remember.
Don't go away.
I haven't moved.
Tell me something nice.
Sure. What do you want to hear?
Lie to me. Tell me all these years you've waited. Tell me.
All these years I've waited.
Tell me you'd have died if I hadn't come back.
I would have died if you hadn't come back.
Tell me you still love me like I love you.
I still love you like you love me.
Thanks a lot.
Stop feeling so sorry for yourself. You think you had it, Ralph. I didn't find this place. I had to build it. How do you think I was able to do that?
I don't want to know.
But I want you to know. For every board, plank, and beam in this place.
I heard enough.
No, you're going to listen.
I told you, I don't want to know anymore.
You can't shut me up, Johnny. Not anymore. Once I would have crawled at your feet to be near you. I searched for you and every man I met.
Look, Vienna, you just said you had a bad dream. We both had, but it's all over.
Not for me.
It's just like it was 5 years ago. Nothing's happened in between.
Oh, I wish...
Not a thing. You've got nothing to tell me, because it's not real. Only you and me. That's real. We're having a drink at the bar in the Aurora Hotel. The band is playing. We're celebrating because we're getting married. And after the wedding, we're getting out of this hotel and we're going away. So laugh, Ian, and be happy. It's your wedding day.
I have waited for you, John. What took you so long?
J'ai dit une fois, et je suis prêt à le redire aujourd'hui devant cette caméra, j'ai dit une fois qu'un film comme Johnny Guitar a eu plus d'importance dans ma vie que dans celle de Nicolas Ray. C'est-à-dire que c'est un film pour lequel je me suis pris de passion dès que je l'ai vu. Mais j'étais critique au moment où je l'ai vu, j'ai écrit dessus, et j'ai écrit dessus plusieurs articles, et on a commencé d'ailleurs comme ça une correspondance avec Nicolas Ray. Mais je parlais de ça à propos de Johnny Guitar, qui est un film effectivement qui a une très grande importance dans ma vie. Je ne sais pas pourquoi, parce que je l'ai trouvé très fort, très profond, sur les relations hommes-femmes. Et je crois que c'est le seul film dans lequel j'ai vu traiter un thème qui est très intéressant dans un certain stade des relations amoureuses, qui est l'amertume. L'amertume de gens qui se sont aimés, qui ne s'aiment plus et qui se revoient. Et je crois qu'aucun film n'a traité ça aussi bien que Johnny Guitar.
All you have to do is come out of the goddamn thing here and come up, you'll drain them.
Shut up!
What?
No!
At points I feel drained of that.
As their concept of the film evolved, Ray and his students continually revised their scenario, endlessly reshooting sequences. By this time, they had been working together for nearly 2 years.
How less... What I feel is that I want to give.
Right, I know.
It's very difficult right now.
As the project's shortage of funds grew critical, production would cease intermittently for want of cash to buy film stock. Ray fell ill that winter and suffered from bouts of despair.
Because when you had her the blankets, you're the one who wanted to come in and warm Tom originally as you did, right?
Right.
And so at this moment...
The company would work when it could, from noon throughout the night until dawn in bitter cold, functioning on a few hours sleep snatched between takes.
Action!
I don't think that I could have gotten a, or I could ever get a, such a good acting teacher. I think he's the greatest teacher of acting in the world. I'm really excited by that. And the reason that I still work on the film, because I've wanted to leave, you know, now for, since May, is because this relationship that I have with Nick is still very exciting. The energy is still very high.
You don't even take time with me anymore.
Play your part or else get your ass off the set. My concentration is on him in this angle, and I don't want your personal hostility or whatever the hell you are feeling to take a part in the film. At this point, not at all. Not at all, at all, at all, Leslie.
My personal hostility is not involved in the film. It's not involved when I walk from there to there. So I don't know what you're talking about.
Well, then, honey, you haven't learned anything about acting.
If that's, you know, your judgment,
right.
Fine, keep it. But I remain immune to it. If I know what I know...
You sure know your immunities, you know.
Yes.
I will not try to convince you.
I will not try to convince you.
All you can do is just cut ass out.
If I waited for you 4 hours tonight, that meant
you
that
didn't
I didn't
wait
want to
for me for
I
4 hours.
I did fucking too.
I beg your pardon.
I beg your pardon.
Tell me when you waited for 4 hours for me.
From 8:15 till 12.
8:15 you called.
That's right.
Who did you talk to?
Judy.
So how did you wait for me?
Because she's part of the crew. I thought there's some kind of communication.
We waited for you, for Christ's sake.
Well, how was I going to get over here?
Somebody was going to come after you
when
you called.
And I called and no one came.
And you were going on the campus.
I was not. You said, don't go on the campus. It'd be better for you
not
to, because then it would take even an hour.
You're talking bullshit.
I am not.
You're talking petty bullshit.
I am not. 4 hours is a lot of time.
You
want to
talk about the part, I'll talk about the part. I will not talk about petty bullshit.
It's not petty bullshit. It's a matter of time. That's all. And if time is of the essence in this film, then it's not petty.
Do you have any questions about this?
No, I just walked from there to there.
Play the actual scene for what it is.
All right.
The way you feel.
All right.
Right. Even though it loves you. The letter
was... No, Sam, I don't want to... I don't want to feel any kind of reluctance at all.
You should. For the scene. Because you wanted to do that thing for him.
Do.
To show him. So it's with reluctance you give them to her.
And that is, this is the only moment of heroic action in the film.
All right, ready for picture, please. Ready. Less okay. Roll them.
Sound on.
Camera on. Speed.
Action.
All right, now, turn that way again.
Cut, cut. Cut, cut.
Sorry. All right.
I like this very much. I just want to see the other kind of graciousness come into it. I want to extend the moment a little longer, because what may take a moment in, or just a second in the thought, is the kind of miracle of film where you can extend that thought into 30 seconds, 40 seconds. Now we want to extend it to 8 seconds. The move was good. So I think it's the move first and then the... Okay, darling, you do it. Leslie! Ah. Wonderful.
Thanks.
I try not to direct them until just before the scene, which is part of what the hassle was about last night. But when a person has the stink of the gallows about her, then you're bound to run into the same thing that you might run into with a Tallulah Bankhead. Or I've only had 2 fights with actors in my life, really. And you use what is of their essence at the moment, because that is their easiest reference point, and you have to be aware of that and how to agitate it, how to make it work for you in the scene. What their immediate concern is.
He showed me about a year ago little bits of the Binghamton film, and some of them were, I couldn't tell what the whole film was like at all. I mean, there wasn't enough of it. But I saw a couple of sequences that were quite amazing and really reminded me of Nick's kind of talent, which he was showing in the days when he was making Rebel Without a Cause, and those extremely passionate and vital pictures about the young.
What makes you think he hates you, Judy?
I don't think. I know. He looks at me like I was the ugliest thing in the world. He doesn't like my friends. He doesn't like one thing about me. He called me... He called me a dirty tramp.
How did you get the part in Rebel?
Well, Nick made a lot of tests of different girls. I think there were about 50 of us, and it sort of narrowed down. There were 50 to begin with, and the second day it was down to 10, and the third day I think it was down to 5 or 6. But the big problem was that I had really up to that point only played children, and although I was 15, the last thing I did was in pigtails or something, and so I was finding it difficult to convince, and Nick was also finding it difficult to convince the studio that I was
out of pigtails. So one day I came on an interview with a boyfriend who had a cut on his face, and Nick said, where did he get that? And I said, drag racing. And then shortly afterward, I was actually in a bad car accident with Dennis Hopper, in which Dennis was driving too fast, and we were all thrown from the car and brought to the hospital. And I was sort of semi-conscious, and the police were called, and they were asking me my parents' phone number, and I kept saying, it's Nick Ray, call Nick Ray, and the number is so forth and so forth, the number of the Chateau Marmont, and I just kept repeating that. And so that's who they did call. And Nick sent his doctor down to the hospital, and then he came down, and I said, Nick, they called me a goddamn juvenile delinquent. Now do I get the part?
And you got it.
And I got it. No director that I'd ever worked with had ever improvised. And Nick's bungalow at the Chateau Marmont, where he lived, was the set was built from that, so that when we rehearsed, we really rehearsed as though in a set, and we improvised most of the scenes.
Could you tell us something about the relationship between Nick Ray and Jimmy Dean?
Well, they obviously had become very close, because before the film started, they sort of hung around together and, as you mentioned, went to New York, and so that Jimmy trusted Nick a great deal. And I think Nick was very fatherly towards Jimmy. I mean, he was to Sal and to myself as well. But I think Nick just absolutely understood Jimmy. They were just completely in tune in personality. I guess maybe Jimmy reminded Nick of himself a great deal. So that there was never any friction, as there was between Jimmy and other directors that he worked with. And it was just a wonderful blend. And Nick brought out this feeling of trust in Jimmy.
But working with Jimmy was... you know, like a real joy. But I had the advantage of his having worked with Kazan, and where he at least had a method beginning. I developed the method a little bit more because Kazan and I matriculated about the same time in the theater, and he had taught me a lot. I think the nicest thing Gage ever said to me was, how did you get that spontaneous performance out of Jimmy? But method changes with damn near every actor. And I honored his imagination more than almost anything else.
You're home. Are you all right? Where were you? We were so worried. I was going to take a sleeping pill, but I wouldn't until I knew you were home.
Can I talk to you guys? I have to talk to somebody. Dad? You better give me an answer this time.
Go ahead.
A direct answer. I'm in trouble. You know that big high bluff? Near Millertown?
Oh, yes, yes. There was a bad accident. They showed the pictures on television, Jim.
I was in it.
How? How can you
do that?
It
doesn't matter how, Dad. I was driving a stolen car.
Oh, that's a fine thing. Do you enjoy doing this to me or what?
I wasn't trying.
And you wanted him to make a list.
Let him tell it.
All right, I'll let him tell
it. She doesn't want to hear. She doesn't care.
I don't care.
I don't care what I say.
You remember how I almost died giving birth to him, and then you say I don't
care.
Please,
relax, relax.
Dean was the only one in the cast who had any real comprehension of method or of the school of theater in which I had grown up. And you couldn't use the word improvise. If you used the word improvise with people like Andoran or Jim Backus or Virginia Brissac, they would say, this arty school, hmm? I'd use old vaudevillian terms. The director has to be able to work with everybody from every school, you know? No cast is ever made up of really the same people, the same background. So you have to use all the techniques you've ever learned, whether it's that of what you learned from a vaudevillian or from an old leading man like Fuller Mellish, who came over with Henry Irving and Minnie Madden Fisk, or burlesque people like Red Buttons or Phil Silvers or from miners or shrimp fishermen or or your own peers as you grow up in the theater. It's a Cary Grant, for instance, is a fellow like Duke Ellington has in his trunk so many tunes. Well, Cary Grant has so many notes of sunsets, so many jokes, so many things that he's collected and remained collecting every single year of his life, you know, that his memory, his effective memory, is always implemented by an easy reference. You know. He has them in the trunk. He doesn't have to refer to them because the compartments of the brain have them, but having written them down, having noted them, having taken the visual memory of, like that tree between those two little shacks there, being something which you might remember in a scene, say, why don't we use that?
After Rebel Without a Cause, Nicholas Ray continued to produce some extraordinary work. Although he was one of Hollywood's most respected directors, Ray still suffered studio interference that Baudelaireized his conception on several films, and he began to work abroad. Thereafter, he drifted from one project to another through the Byzantine complications of independent production and multinational financing. Compromises were still required, but Ray did enjoy a measure of autonomy beyond that generally accorded him in Hollywood. Then, in 1960, he was drawn into the world of blockbuster spectacles. Although he brought his immense visual talent and some original conceptions to the rather inflated material, Nicholas Ray seemed glaringly out of place, overseeing the massive technology and impersonal logistics of a King of Kings or a 55 Days at Peking.
for noise. Different nations saying the same thing at the same time. We want China.
Why did he get discouraged? This is the terrible evil, I think, of the Hollywood system. I think you end up, because you do get screwed occasionally by studios, you do get frustrated. They do mess up your work and make it more difficult for you to work, or they did in those days when the studios really existed. They don't really exist anymore in that sense. I think Nick was probably much more vulnerable than other people. Everybody has this. But whereas a man like Kazan was able, who's tough as nails, was able to take it in stride, I think Nick finally was partially destroyed by it and became almost perverse in his resistance, in his almost being prepared to be screwed before anticipating the screwings before they actually occurred. Now, that is not rare. That happens to many directors and many people who work in the business. It affected Nick more than other people.
Most film courses or film classes concentrate on, you know, getting rid of the responsibilities to the students as quickly as possible by putting them off in corners and shooting 8mm films, which they can do all by themselves. And present for a senior thesis. Therefore, the emphasis is on kind of static camera with with cute ideas or masturbatory ideas or date-making ideas or anything except the relationship with other human beings. And film is a collective art. It's an eclectic art. It's a collective art. And it's, by its own nature, become the most communicative art that we have in the world. And the only two great ambassadors we've ever had from the United States have been jazz and film. And that doesn't come from sitting off in a corner.
For all his hardships, Nicholas Ray remains both intransigent and optimistic, facing an uncertain future, determined to make films in his own way. In a sense, each project he undertakes might be likened to the blind run in Rebel Without a Cause, as a slightly mad test of courage that leads him up to and perhaps over the edge of disaster. While Ray did find in Binghamton momentarily a kind of community and collective endeavor for which he had long been searching, in the end, Nick Ray knows that he must drive his blind run alone. As he has often remarked, the working title of every film he has ever made has been, I'm a Stranger Here Myself.
The low camera on this, it might be good emotionally for you to take the low camera. And she's putting the blankets on Tom.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, go ahead.
Did you tip up to her?
What do you mean? I take a camera that's
the low camera. As the blankets come on to her. You should be 75 here. Yeah. And you tip up into it. I think it's emotionally a good thing.
All right, okay.
Footage, please.
155.
It looks very beautiful to me.
Since we brought them, right?
That's a wrap.